Welcome back. The client credentials flow in OAuth is meant for machine-to-machine communication. Using this flow, there is no interactive user involved. In the coming minutes, you'll hear more about the details of the flow, the do's and don'ts, what a token looks like, and how it is used. I'm Roland Guit for Duende Software, the makers of Identity Server. We help you to create secure applications in your organization. Now let's dive in. On this slide, you see the client, the authorization server, and the resources that consist of APIs we call API 1, API 2, etc. I've covered the role of each in another video, which I encourage you to watch first if you haven't already. The client here could, for example, be a worker process or maybe an API outside of our organization that wants to access one of ours. First, the client has to do a request to the authorization server to get a token that is needed to access one or more resources in the form of APIs. And that token is called an access token. The request looks like this. It has to specify the grant type to use. An OAuth flow defines the overall process for obtaining the access token, while a grant specifies the exact mechanism used within that process to acquire the token. But these terms are often used interchangeably. The client must also indicate what resource, so which API in this case, it wants to access by specifying at least one scope. Multiple scopes can be delimited with a space, but requesting more than one scope doesn't result in multiple access tokens. The client will always receive one token suitable for all resources requested. The client is pre-registered on the authorization server. In other words, the authorization server must know upfront the client exists. That is needed because we don't want it to hand out tokens to unknown clients. To uniquely identify a client ID is used together with a client secret, so that the client can authenticate with the authorization server during the authorization request. In this case, the client ID and secret are encoded in the authorization header. At this point, the authorization server will check if the client ID and secret, its credentials, are correct, and if it's allowed to access the scopes. That information must also be pre-configured on the authorization server. If everything checks out, it will respond with a body that contains a JSON document. In the document is the actual access token, the scope that was granted, the type of token and how long the access will be valid for in seconds. So the client will be able to call the API using this access token for 1 hour, and after that it has to get a new one. The client can now put the token in the authorization header when it wants to access the API. Using a header is a good idea because HTTP headers typically aren't logged and browsers assume they contain sensitive data. Bearer indicates that a standard OAuth token is used. Here's how this looks like in C#. We first have to get the access token and then use it to call the API. And this project uses a library called Duende Identity Model to help with accessing the authorization server. It first gets the discovery document and then uses the token endpoint URL in the response to request the token. It passes in client ID and secret as well as the scope. The authorization server will verify if the client exists and if it's allowed to request the scope. If all is good, it will generate the response we saw earlier. And calling the API looks like this. The token is first included in the authorization header and then we call the API as normal. Remember that the client is only allowed to forward the token to the API. It may not consume it. But it does know some details about the token because these were in the JSON document that was returned from the authorization server. When the token is received, it's the responsibility of the API to verify the token signature before using it. No need to write that code yourself. There are libraries for that. After verification, it can also check if the token is meant for it by checking the scope and optionally give limited access to the API when there are multiple scopes configured for that particular API. When the token is successfully validated by the API, you'll get an HTTP status code back in the 200 range. If not, either a 401 or a 403 is returned. So what's the difference? 401 means you're trying to access a resource with a token, but the token isn't valid. It might be missing, expired, or it couldn't be validated for some reason. In a tested environment, this almost always means that the token was expired and a new one should be fetched. 403 means the token is okay, but you're not allowed access to what you're trying to do. Typically, you don't have the right scope in the access token. Finally, we have to think about token management on the client. We don't have to request a new token for every API call. It can be used for multiple calls as long as they occur within the allowed time window. So tokens have to be stored on clients, using one of the ways shown here. And also some logic should be in place to get a new token when needed. There are two approaches for that. The proactive approach would be to keep track of the expiration and renew the token ahead of time. And the reactive approach would just be to wait for the HTTP status code 401 and then get a new token. In .NET, there's a library available to do all this called Duende Access Token Management. Using that, a client can be defined, configuring the token endpoint to call, as well as the client ID and secret, and the scope. Now a special HTTP client instance using the client configuration can be used to do the actual API call. And it will automatically take care of requesting and caching the access token, as well as replacing it for a new one proactively. That was it for this video. Stay tuned for the next one in the series.